They use neighbouring troughs and peaks as a good approximation of where the finger starts and ends, and then we can trace along those to finally create a hand pose. And that hand pose we can then use as a driver for input for games, so we can work out if the fingers are extended, if they're closed.
The system just uses the Nintendo Wiimote from the Wii. It connects to the computer via Bluetooth. Four markers on the end of the fingertips are then picked up by a camera on the Nintendo Wiimote. It's an infrared camera, and the system utilizes a library developed by Brian Peake called Wiimote Lib, which is freely available via CodePlex. We built the three-dimensional tracking capability on top of that library. It uses planar homography to be able to work out where the points are in 3D space. So we have a plane at the front and a plane at the back, and we do an intersection of lines to each of the LEDs via those two planes, and we can work out where things are in 3D. There are four LEDs on the end of the fingers. They're powered by this unit on the back here. Essentially, it's a USB rechargeable unit as well. When the kit's out in the home, you can just plug it into the PC and charge it via the PC. The glove has been designed so we can swap for different size finger pieces, so we can detach and reattach it up there. So for different users, we can use different lengths of wire. We can also use individual finger attachments as well. The games which you can see on the screen are essentially, they're produced in Microsoft's XNA framework, which is a game development framework which people can also use to distribute to Xbox 360.
Around 15 million people have a stroke every year. The kind of movements people have to make post-stroke are pronation, supination, reach to grasp, and then grasp, pick an object up and put it down in another place.
You have the peg test where you have to pinch, pick up and drop down. And what we've done is we've mapped that interaction to pinch and release like so. So if I'll just show you that now. Essentially what I do is I pinch to activate the ball, and then I release to fire the ball. It's a fun and interesting project to do. The main difficulties I would say would be actually building a system which can be deployed into the home. So rather than having a system that just works in a research lab, we had to actually make it so it was robust enough to work in the real world environment. And that's where the difficulty came in as far as coding and that sort of thing goes.
So part of the problems that we had with this system were things like phantom IR reflection. So this works off a series of infrared emitting diodes, but we're getting other infrared sources from around the house, such as perhaps a television remote. If you're wearing a glove, there might be patient discomfort, there might be hygiene issues, you might find it difficult to get the glove on. There's lots of little technical parts on the glove which can get broken. So we're looking now whether we can use the Kinect camera as a markerless system where you don't have to wear anything at all for fast and robust tracking in a home environment.
All right, what we've got in front of us now is essentially a hand tracking system that takes advantage of the depth map features of the Kinect camera. So in computer vision research, traditionally there's been a lot of background in using colour-based cameras to extract people's hands and hand pose information from a scene. And they work really, really well in a tightly controlled lab setting. So when you've got things like green screen, very tight control of the lighting conditions, but that doesn't translate well into a real home setting and a practical kind of use scenario for a home-based stroke rehabilitation system. Now, the advantage of the Kinect is that instead of giving you a colour feed, it actually gives you a depth map of the scene. So instead of having colour information encoded in pixels, it encodes the distance in millimetres of each pixel in the scene. And it's much more tolerant to environmental conditions and things like skin tone. This is a proof of concept game designed to test the tracking system. So it's based on the slingshot game we saw earlier using the Wiimote. And this is designed to try the exercise some arm synergy. So we're using the shoulder, elbow, that reach and the pinch and grasp. The game randomly positions a ball on the screen, and I just need to move my hand over the ball, grab it and throw to the target, and then a ball will reappear. And we've got kind of a developer mode to help us see what's going on. So you can see it's finding kind of that large red circle, which is really the key element of the hand tracking, where it's trying to find the center of the palm. We then try to look at nearby information to determine fingertips, pits of the fingers, and we can use that to eventually create these kind of purple lines that we can trace along to find the depth information about the fingers, and from that calculate a hand pose. We essentially locate the hand in the scene, segment all the other information, remove everything we're not interested in, background, your arm, your face. So you've only got the hand left on the depth map. We then trace around that hand contour, so we create a kind of a contour route around the outside of your hand, and this helps account for a lot of the missing information. So you might have blank spots within the hand, but because we're now only looking at the contour, we kind of eliminate all those. We then try and find the largest area inside that contour, because that invariably turns out to be the palm of the hand. We then do some distance analysis of the contour away from the centre of the palm. We do some filtering to smooth that out, and this helps us classify the distance graph into peaks and troughs, and we then classify maximal points as fingertips and minimal points as finger troughs, and we can simply use neighbouring troughs and peaks as a good approximation of where the finger starts and ends, and then we can trace along those to finally create a hand pose. And that hand pose we can then use as a driver for input for games, so we can work out if the fingers are extended, if they're closed. Okay, so Kinect is a novel depth-based camera, so it uses a structured light approach. So instead of actually just being one camera that you might think of traditionally, it has an infrared projector. So it's projecting a pattern in infrared light onto everything in the scene that we can't see. It then uses an infrared camera to look at that pattern, and it looks for distortions in the pattern and eventually uses triangulation to calculate the depth in the scene. The downside to that is that it's not particularly accurate. We have done some experiments to try and verify the accuracy because we're using it for clinical purposes. It also tends to generate a lot of missing information, especially on small objects, which is quite a big problem when you're looking at something like the hand, because fingertips can quite often disappear. Now, a time-of-flight camera, like this one I have here, has traditionally been a lot more expensive, so this camera is in the region of several thousand pounds to buy. But this actually projects infrared light and measures the time it takes for it to travel back into the camera. So that creates a much more accurate depth map because it's not reliant on other information and the size of objects within the scene. The Kinect 2 camera is reported to use a very, very similar camera to this. I believe the camera develops even by the same company. So we're really excited to see kind of what we'll be able to do with the same kind of technology and low cost camera as a Kinect that's definitely suitable for home use because it's designed for playing games in the home, but with the kind of the accuracy we've got used to from these kind of cameras. A camera like this would traditionally cost between £2,000 to £4,000. So these are the kind of cameras that have been applied for industrial use in production lines, monitoring. But the Kinect really revolutionised the depth camera scene, so it was the first kind of real low-cost consumer available, depth camera available, and it's had a huge impact on computer vision. Technology is just getting better and better, and I think it will make a huge impact not just on our research team but on the kind of this whole field in general. Kinect 2 will be out at Christmas with the launch of the new Xbox One, but we're hoping that we can get on the developer list, so there is a list for people to get the SDK early if they're doing interesting enough projects. So hopefully, yeah. I think it relies on something like photon shift, but really I'm more interested in using it than I'll leave that to physicists to work out.
It's whether they can write some code. Show me your code and I can give you a job.